Hello once again. This is Pastor John Carlo, and we're here with World Video TV Talk Show. And we want to give you some outright information today that you may never believe until you hear it from us.
Amen.
We're three retired cops.
That's right. 60 years, John.
Yep. And I'm going to ask these two wonderful fellas if they'd share something about who they are. Bill?
First of all, I'd like to thank you for supporting the Ministry of Police Officers for Christ for so many years. And by the way, I never publicly thanked you for encouraging me 50 years ago to become the police officer that I eventually became. It was due to your encouragement as a transit police. So that's one aspect of our lives interconnecting.
Amen.
As policemen. And down through the years, you've supported our effort to bring the gospel to police work.
Yeah.
And so my name is Bill Vella, retired PD, over 35 years of retired, and God called me into the ministry with Faith Community Church. Pastor Gary Comas and his dear wife, Reverend Doreen, has blessed me and my wife as elders and ministers on the leadership. And I'm grateful for my brother David,
Amen.
Reverend David Villarreal.
Amen.
I know he's been wonderful experiences in the job, and that's what we're here for.
Okay.
We're really here to show a new perspective on police work in this city.
Amen.
And I'd like to read Romans 13. This is what we shared in the New York City Police Department, that all authority is ordained of God.
Amen.
And it's his calling, not only as a policeman. There is a calling there. I know there was a calling on my life. But the main reason for that calling is found in Romans. Romans 13, it says, obey the government, for God is the one who has put it there. There is no government anywhere that God has not placed in power. So those who refuse to obey the laws of the land are refusing to obey God. And punishment will follow. For the policeman does not frighten people who are doing right, but those doing evil will always fear the policeman. So if you don't want to be afraid, keep the laws, you will get along well. The policeman is sent by God to help you. But if you are doing something wrong, of course you should be afraid, for he will have you punished. He is sent, oh, I love this portion, he is sent by God for that very purpose. So obey the laws, then for two reasons. First, you might be punished. And second, because you know it's true. It should be. We should obey the laws. That's what's happening in our culture and society, right? We're seeing a out-and-out rebellion against the authorities that are in power. And so God called us. But one of the brothers who was involved in starting the ministry, Jerry Francis, of who you well know,
yes,
Pastor, and myself, and my brother Dave, he was the one that got the vision, and he put it on an index card and put it in all of the Manhattan South precincts to see if there were other men who had experienced what the Bible calls being born again. And I happened to see it in, I had a collar, I had an arrest in the Fifth Precinct. And I did the paperwork, and all of a sudden I see this card, and I'm reading the card, and it's giving you an address and a time, and so I couldn't believe it, in a sense, you know. But I was determined to go and see what this was all about, and sure enough, there was over 100 police officers.
Wow.
That first meeting, and ever since that day, until this day, to this day, over 35, 40 years, the Ministry of Police Officers of Christ is still functioning in the department. Now you say, well, why have another organization when you have other spiritual organizations? The difference with us, as opposed to the Protestant, the St. George Society, or the Catholics in the police department, the difference was that we were non-denominational. We received anyone who had had an experience with Christ. And so that gave us a greater voice, because there was a lot of men and women that were, you know, they were really on the sidelines spiritually.
Yeah.
And so that's basically why he formed this ministry. And he's blessed it.
Like you said, it's still here today, which is
It is still here today. Now, I had given some photos to some of the producers of the program, showing what the ministry was led to do, you know. And we were so active, proactive, in a sense.
With miracles, signs, and wonders.
Exactly, too. Exactly.
We had a lot of these officers things that were walking into some terrible places, and
that's right.
Shots were being fired and everything, and that's thank right. God, not one of them got hit.
Thank God is right.
Yeah.
Thank God is
better
right.
Better than a vest.
Oh, and how I can relate to that. You know, ministry is a wonderful thing if you're obedient. God expects us to be obedient.
And it's not always easy.
It isn't, especially as a police officer, you know.
People look at you, and they look at the uniform rather than you.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
Well, let's give Dave a shot.
Yeah.
Dave.
Sure. How are you? So you guys, before we start,
tell us about yourself.
Yeah, I want to take a second just to thank Reverend Bill for reaching out to me and allowing me, when he heard there was an opportunity to come down here to share. He asked me if I was willing to do it. I said, absolutely. Yeah. And so I thank you, and I thank Pastor John for opening the store and inviting me to come along. So my name is Dave Villarreal. I'm retired. I'm a retired sergeant. Police Department. I retired 14 years ago. Not as long as these guys, but I'm retired. I'm at 14 years, and I'm grateful. I'm grateful for many things, and you know, there's so many. I can get into a whole slew of things. I'll just touch on. I'm thankful. I'm thankful first and foremost to have Christ in my life. I always share with the different people. I heard about Jesus since I was this big, since I was a little tot, but it wasn't until I was at a crossroads in my life where I was at a place of desperation. I'm saying where I called upon Him, and He met me where I was at. And I'll get into that later on. But I'm grateful. So I'm a retired sergeant from the police department. I retired in 2010. I too, as Reverend Bill, I'm a minister in a faith community church under Pastor Gary and Reverend Doreen, and we're not too far. We're actually in the same area as Pastor John. We're ministering to the community here on Staten Island, and it's been nothing but a good ride. It's been a good ride, and I'm thankful to be in this stage of life I'm in now. I'm saying I'm grateful, and I'm not just saying that. Just, my hope and prayer is that we're able to share like we're doing now with that many more people. I'm saying to just let people know who Christ is to us and how real He is and how ever present He is.
Amen. Also, I'm Pastor John Carlo, senior pastor of the Christian Pentecostal Church, and I did 28 years in the police department in transit, which was one of the worst places to live because you were by yourself.
Amen.
But I'll tell you this. God took me through many crazy situations. I've Amen. Walked out of the, and in and out of the places where you shouldn't be walking out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but God protected us. It was kind of funny. We were just talking about something that God loves cops.
Yes, he does.
Because he's trying to keep, he's using them to keep the peace, although many times it doesn't end up like that. We were just talking about how the Apostle Paul, who was a murderer, and he was a policeman. He was working for the temple police. He had arrest warrants to go arrest these Christians. So as he's going into Damascus, he gets knocked down by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And Christ opens a door for him to be one of his disciples, to bring the gospel all over the known world. Now, of all people, would you make him a disciple? But look what happened. When he gives his testimony in the book of Ephesians, he describes it this way. I was apprehended by Jesus Christ. Not just a witness, he got apprehended.
Amen.
And look what he accomplished for the Lord, going to all different places, countries, and in all kinds of problems and troubles, and where he could have been killed and so on and so forth. I think that the greatest thing we can do is tell you that being a policeman is a tough job, but a Christian policeman is a man or woman that can be out there and bring more than just an arrest.
Yes.
We have opportunities sometimes. I've had people walk up to me, tell me they want to kill themselves, or things like this. And the Spirit of God just gives you the right words to say at the right time to help people. And again, we have, unfortunately, with the press in many cases, all they put down is the best or the worst instance that happened. What about all the different people that they've saved from all kinds of situations?
Right.
Because when you're working as a policeman, you're absorbing all the people's troubles, all comes into you, and you may be having the same problem. And unfortunately, a lot of cops kill themselves because it's overwhelming. But we're here to tell you one thing.
Yes.
God loves cops. And if you're thinking about a job where you want to do missionary work, being a policeman is one of the best jobs ever is.
Amen.
One good thing about it is when you're talking to somebody, they can't walk away.
That's true. Captive audience.
But again, it's a way of winning people to Christ by letting them know that it's not just about being arrested. Sometimes that's the only way that problem get fixed.
Yeah.
It has to come to light. But the thing is, we're here not just for that. We're here for spirituality as well.
Amen.
That people can change and become a different person in Christ.
Amen.
I know when the Cops for Christ, we had so many meetings where people came in and had just come from work.
That's right.
And they were involved in all kinds of situations where bullets were flying all
That's
over
right.
the place. And thank God not one of them hit them.
Amen.
But
Amen.
Also it's good to know that God uses men and women of authority.
Hmm.
Not in the wrong way, but in the right way.
Yeah.
I know myself, when I was in a major case unit in the Detective Bureau, and as a captain, we were locking people up, people who were not supposed to be people getting locked up. We had rabbis, priests, and all kinds of people that were doing crazy things. But the thing was that a lot of policemen have a good heart. They do.
Amen.
But having a good heart is not enough. Sometimes the only way a person can get saved from the problem, it has to be brought out into the light. And then they start with, yes, I have that problem.
Yeah.
And hopefully we're working with the courts and everybody else, and also the church. That person can become a totally new person in Christ.
Amen.
I know we have a lot of stories here. How about telling a couple of them?
So many stories, John. Just to back up what you're saying, you know, our God is real.
Definitely.
And he...
And so's the devil. We met him too.
That's right. We've met him on the streets.
A lot of places.
Many times. But greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. You know? And I'm so grateful for the fact that he not only put this word in me, but he asked me to go out into all the world. The Bible says that you shall receive power.
That's right.
When the Holy Ghost shall come upon you.
Mm-hmm.
And you shall be what?
Witnesses.
Witnesses. Witnesses of Jerusalem, in Jerusalem,
mm-hmm.
Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts.
Yes.
Pastor John, I can honestly, truthfully tell you, I've been to every portion of that scripture, including the uttermost part.
Yes.
If the pictures have been brought up, they show us under a sign in West Berlin. The year is 1980, and we were invited as a ministry, Police Officers for Christ, to this ministerial occasion that was taking place in the western part of Berlin. In fact, it was in the stadium, held in the stadium that Adolf Hitler built in 1936 for the Olympics, and Jesse Owen won the Olympic gold medal there. We were there.
Yeah.
And some of the pictures show us with different ministries, like Nicky Cruz and so many other, Cho from Korea, the largest church, was present, and so many other ministries. 700 Club was there with James. Anyway, the bottom line was that we were asked to go to be a part of the team of the 700 Club and walk across the border into communist East Germany and minister the gospel of Christ while we were there. I had the privilege of sharing with this young person in East Germany. They had nothing. They had nothing. The communist regime, you could see the difference between the communist system and the Western system. And so this young man, he had nothing really. And he received the word of God and accepted Christ. And I promised him that when I got back to the U.S., I would mail him a Bible. And so I get home and I go into the post office with my Bible and everything, and they tell me East Germany doesn't accept Bibles.
I said, dangerous.
Send it anyway. I said, send it anyway.
Amen.
Prayed over it, send it anyway. 3 weeks later, I get a picture of the boy, the young boy, and the Bible that he had under his hand. So there's no barriers when it comes to the Word of God, especially in my life. I mean, I've literally seen the Word of God break every yoke, including barriers, including... I have to thank you also, besides encouraging me to be the police officer, you were the first one I went to when I moved back to the city, and you know, I was looking around to see where God would have me to be, and I noticed the prison. There was a prison, and you encouraged me by giving me an opportunity to go under your banner. And through that experience, they let Faith Community Church, which I was an elder in, they gave us two Sundays. And so we were going in twice a month, bringing the gospel.
Amen.
And so we
that's what God wants from us.
That's it.
I mean, it's nice to be in church.
Exactly.
But that's not what he wants. He wants us to take that out. For example, I was thinking when you were talking, the angels that God has are all cops.
That's right.
They're helping people all over the place, right? And I'm here to tell you something, that there's some of them that are in a uniform of the New York City Police Department that God is sending to different places too to help people.
Right.
It's not just arresting people. It's helping people that are in all kinds of problems. I remember one
it's
night,
true.
It was during the Vietnam War. I was working... that lower Manhattan, it was like 3 o'clock in the morning. And this young African young man came up to me and says, "Officer, I'm gonna kill myself." I looked at him and I says, "Well, why would you wanna do that?" I saw he had some military jacket on, and he told me that he had just come back from Vietnam, and he finds out that his wife has a baby, but it isn't his. And he wanted to kill himself. And I had a chance to talk to him and pray with him, and it was like you could see something came off him. I says, "Go back to your wife. You love your wife?" "Yes, I love her, but look what she did." I says, "Well, You're going to have to learn to forgive her. You have a child. And I pray that that young man received exactly what we prayed for.
Amen.
But again, a lot of people don't like the policemen because they don't like to be caught. It's as simple as that. So unfortunately, there are a lot of bad people.
Yes.
But I tell you this, bad people can become good people too. We've seen that.
That's right.
So.
And sometimes it takes a cop. You talk about outreach. Outreach.
That's right. That's right.
I was telling the guys recently about when I was working at Coney Island as a sergeant, we were getting a lot of petty little things people doing. And we would really do for the heavy stuff, especially during different holidays. And there was a church just starting on near the boardwalk. I get the man's name was Jack. So I stopped, I got in the radio car and I went over there and I had a talk with him. I says, listen, we got a lot of people, especially at night, doing all kinds of stupid things. And it's arrestable, but it's not heavy duty stuff. I said, would you mind, instead of us arresting them, could we bring them to your church, which was open 24/7?
Wow.
So I started doing it, and then other cops started doing it too, who weren't even Christians. And we were loading this man up with people with problems. But he was the kind of person who said, keep bringing them, keep bringing them. And I kind of laughed about it, but I says Jesus must be laughing. People say, I came to Christ. Well, you came this way.
That's okay.
But again, God, I pray that more policemen officers would come to Christ, because we have something that the average cop doesn't have.
We have
the Holy Spirit in us.
That's right.
He protects us, but he also lets us know when things are true or false.
Yeah. Yes.
Even in ministry, when I sit down with people for counseling, I said, listen, I got to tell you this before we start. Tell me the truth. I've been a cop, and I can tell you right away when you're lying. And if you're lying, I can't help you. And they start laughing, and then here comes the truth. And then we can deal with it. And I think it's the same thing with God. We can't come to God until we say, I need you. I messed up, and look at the mess I made.
That's right, repent.
And that's what we're mimicking, the same thing. But the good thing about being a cop is when you have somebody to talk to, sometimes you kind of,
sure,
I want to talk to you.
Sure.
And especially as a Christian, you can see there's a problem. And I mean, I've seen demonic work and all kinds of things like this. I've seen kids, maybe 11 or 12 years old, throw cops across the room like, how'd that happen? But again, the Organization of Cops for Christ was bringing something to the department that it needed. Mm-hmm. It needed a spiritual thing. Because cops are funny. When I was working in different commands, I would try to give them some spiritual things, little Bibles that you see from some of the organizations, and they wouldn't take them. But if I left them in the coffee room, they'll steal them.
Sure.
But the thing is that a lot of them, I took the Bible, but I'm going to keep it in my heart. Not because they got saved, but because they want to get killed.
Sure.
But the thing is, you see so much terrible things. It's the same in the military, same thing. When you see a lot of terrible things happening, you need good things to kind of balance it out. And I think if you're a young person today and you're looking for an organization, you want to do work for God, join the police department.
Amen.
Because it's made for you. You're going in places where there's trouble. Troubled people.
That's right.
People that, in some cases, were in church at one time and messed up. And perhaps you, through the Holy Spirit, can help them get back to where they are.
Amen.
Or where they should be.
Amen.
What do you think, Dave?
I think that's you're on point. I think both of you guys are on point. So some stories I have. My time on the job. So I spent another backdrop of me. I retired in 2010. I had just about 19 years on the job, and I spent most of my career as Pastor John. I spent most of my career in the Detective Bureau. I was running around the city of New York. I was spent a lot of time in the Gang Division, Narcotics Division, executing search warrants and banging doors down, locking guys up, bad guys.
Hell.
And I was locking up bad guys for many years. Yeah, exactly. So just a quick backdrop on how I never realized how God's hand was on my life even before I came to really know Him. I came to know Christ in 2010. So I spent most of my entire career on the job without walking with Jesus. I knew of him, but I didn't know him personally. And I looked
back. You weren't arrested by him.
I wasn't arrested. He was still chasing. He was still chasing me down. He was still trying to apprehend me. Exactly. He was chasing me down for many years, and I kept fighting. But I look back at just a quick story. I look back at how I was. I think it was 1997. I was involved in a shooting out here in Staten Island. Myself and my old partner, and we were involved in a shooting with 10 individuals. There were 10 individuals who fired upon us, and they fired like 50 something rounds at us. And it was about they were no more than 25 feet away from us. It was crazy. And I look back now, there was nothing between us. We had no cover. I look back now how God's hand was on us. Thank God none of us, neither her nor I, were shot. I'm saying so that was one example of how God was
protected
us, exactly. Yeah. So I can go on with this. I have stories upon stories like you guys. I can go on and on and on about the job and stuff like that, but I never really had the opportunity to share Christ while I was on the job because I didn't, like I said, I knew of him, but I didn't know him then. But now fast forward now, so in 2010, I retire, and now like the last couple of years, we've had the opportunity, myself and Reverend Bill, to actually get out there. God put something in our hearts and to get out there and to share this message with the cops and the precincts and local precincts on the island and even over the bridge in Brooklyn South. And there's been open doors where we were able to go and address the cops. And the reason we're out there sharing the gospel with them is because the last several years, guys have been, the job itself has been tough.
Yeah.
It's been a tough time. It's been a tough time the last couple of years to be a cop. I'm saying, you don't need to be a rocket scientist to figure that out. So, and guys are under a lot of pressure. And like Pastor John said before, the pressure was so tight. It was coming down on them so much. The pressures of the job and whatever else was taking place at home, because you know cops are human too. There's things that go on at home as well. And guys, the hours and the workload and the finances, whatever the case may be, and guys were coming to the point where they were actually taking their own lives. They would come to a place where they felt there was no hope, and we wanted to bring the message of hope, and that's what we were out there. We went to different precincts on the islands, numerous times over the past couple of years, and we actually had the opportunity to share with them, and let them know, listen, we're not the end all be all, but we're pointing them to where the hope was, where the hope. We found, and that was in Christ. I'm saying, and we extended it. We put out the phone numbers out there. We gave them invites to church. We gave them scripture and stuff, and little Gospels of John, and encouraged them. And we had the opportunity to pray with them, and it's been a blessing. So I just, I say the testimonies we were the sharing with the different cops in the precincts and the stories in the past.
Yep.
My best encounter. The best story I have is when Jesus Christ met me in the intensive care unit in the hospital.
Amen. Amen.
That's my best story.
Amen.
That's it. Amen. That's it. When Christ, I was.
Can I add?
Go ahead. Yes.
I was there, literally there, as an elder in the church, and my wife was an elder, so we were present when my brother Reverend Dave was undergoing all of what needed to be done in his body. Mm-hmm. And so the surgeon came in to where we were, you know, waiting with his mother and his stepfather. And he said, you better start praying because all of his vital signs were shutting down. Mm-hmm. And so he went back to do what he had to do, and we did what we were doing. We got on our knees, and we pressed in to what God really wants to do, and that is to heal. He's still in the healing business.
That's right.
We were there to believe that as elders in the church. We believe the prayer of faith can raise the sick, and if they committed any sins, they shall be forgiven.
Amen.
And that's exactly what happened that day, because the surgeon came back 20 minutes later and said, I don't know what you were doing, but keep on doing it because his vital signs are all coming back.
Amen.
A miracle.
And so
So, yeah, same. Amen, Rev. So, just a little backdrop to tie this all in. So what Reverend Bill's referring to. I told you before I was at a crossroads in my life. So in 2010, I was just coming up on my 19th year on the job, and I was diagnosed with stage four colon cancer. I was given 6 months to live, and I was in a bad place. I was in a really bad place, and everything was just my life didn't. Not just a 360, but a 720 quick. You know, what I once knew life as was just like, you know, my life just totally turned around. I was fighting for my life. And quick story, just I emergency surgery. I got diagnosed on May 3rd, 2010. May 15th, I have a surgery. And they removed part of my colon and part of my bladder and my gallbladder and stuff. And I underwent major 17 rounds of chemo. And I go in for another surgery in 2011, January 2011, and I almost didn't make it out of surgery. I almost didn't make it out of the operating room that time. The doctors put me in a medically induced coma, and they told my family I had a 10% chance of living through the night. And like I said, my mom, the praying mom that she was, praise God, amen. I'm grateful for my mom. She kept her composure, and she didn't get rattled. She reached out to the church and the pastor and the elders of the church came up and they prayed and believed God and by the grace of God, I'm here to tell you, listen, there's nothing short of a miracle. It's not about me. I'm here to say this. It's not about me. It's about who He is and what He did. I'm saying, so I'm here to share this testimony to give Christ the glory. I'm saying, so nothing short of a miracle. I'm why I'm alive. By the grace of God, 12 days later, I woke from the coma and the rest is history. I'm not running marathons. I'm not running marathons, but I'm here 14 years later, praise God, cancer free, thank God. And I'm grateful. I remember waking up in the intensive care unit. I remember waking up in the ICU in the hospital, in North Shore Hospital, and I was asleep for like 12 days, and I was so weak I couldn't even lift my finger or blink my eye. But I remember I was fairly new in the Lord. I had come to church several months prior to that. And I remember I knew of Christ and I accepted Christ a few months prior in my church, but it wasn't until that night I was in that intensive care unit when I woke up. When I woke up in that intensive care unit that night is when I surrendered my heart to Jesus. Amen. And that's the night that I knew I went to sleep with a peace in my heart. Amen. That I knew.
Amen.
I knew I was gonna get out of there. And I'm not saying this. I'm not running marathons. I promise. I said, you know, if you get me through this, I promise to turn my life around and to do my best to live a life unto you and to share. I share this testimony to give Him glory. I want to let people know that what Christ did for me, He can do for you. No matter what it is that you're going through. It says He's a respecter of no persons, as the Bible says.
Right.
And He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what He did then, He still does today. He's still in the healing business. So whether it be physical healing, emotional healing, spiritual healing, He's there. All you have to do is call in the name of Jesus.
That's right.
Surrender to Him and listen, throw the towel and say, listen, I can't do this. That's what I did. I couldn't do it. It was out of my hands. And God, He met me where I was at. And I'm so grateful and thankful.
So true.
And just so
true.
God is good.
I'm going to give you a funny story. Cops are very, what am I looking for? Superstitious.
Yes.
I was working as a sergeant, uniform sergeant, and, you know, we have roll calls, right, before they go out, telling them different things that are happening and what to look out for. Anyway, just before this one incident happened, I was saying, how can I reach some of these guys? They're in trouble. You could see they're in trouble. Not so much in the job, but the trouble at home, with all the other things going on. And I started doing this at roll call. Do everything I'm supposed to do. I give everything, and I say, let God bless us on this tour, right? And then I turn them out, go to different posts. One night, it was very busy, and for some reason or other, I forgot to say anything about God. So I yell out, fall out, what's wrong with you people? Get it, fall out. They said, we're not moving until you give us the blessing. And I thought about that, and I says, you know what? You got to know something about police work. You're walking through the valley of the shadow of death every single day.
That's right.
And evil everywhere around you. And I'm not talking about just a nice neighborhood. It's in every neighborhood on different scale.
Yeah.
And we walk into it. And sometimes you can't see it coming.
Yeah.
But the thing is, and I've been in shootouts and all kinds of things in my career. And I say, Lord, thank you. Because I should be dead. When I was born 80 years ago, I should have died. And the Lord brought me back. And I'm saying, God, you're real.
Amen.
You're real.
Yeah.
Yes, he is.
And that's the note that we want to tell everybody, not just the police.
Yes. Everybody.
Yes.
They're a special group because they see the worst things that people can do to each other.
That's right.
You almost want to kill somebody when you see what they did to a kid.
Yes,
sure.
Something else, and you got to restrain yourself.
Yes.
But again, we see evil. We see the Satan and what he does in people's lives.
Yes.
And guess what? Without Christ, that bulletproof vest doesn't help you from getting hurt.
That's right.
It's true.
You're right.
They come at you different ways.
You're right.
So true.
If we would, if our cops would come to Christ, we'd have a different country.
You're right. Absolutely.
It's true. It's
different
true.
City.
You're right. You're right. Big time.
Yeah. Can you picture? Can you picture a radio car? And its sector, and the men and women in that car, know the Lord and as their personal Savior. I mean, come on. They have to make a difference in their sector.
Sure.
And that's the way it was with us, in a sense. You know.
I've had guns pulled on me, and not fire. And I'm saying, Lord, thank you.
Amen.
Because the devil doesn't want you out there.
Amen.
No.
But I'm saying you want to go to you don't need to go to the United States Army or the Marine Corps. There's plenty of stuff going on right there in our own city.
The thing
is that real men and real women of God can walk through the valley of the shadow of death.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And can help people. And you'd be surprised how just a few words to somebody who's hurting, you can point them in the right direction.
Yeah.
Amen.
Maybe it's a church.
Amen.
Maybe it's a program. But we are God's angels, so to speak.
That's right.
We see it, we feel it. The Spirit of God in us tells us there's something wrong.
Yep.
And we can use that to help them. But again, like anything else, you can't help anyone who doesn't want help.
Yes.
But you can plant a seed.
Yes.
And believe it or not, I had an officer that I worked with for years. And I don't know what happened in his life. But he didn't want to know nothing about religion. Nothing at all. He would make fun of it and the whole thing. Anyway, he retired from the job. He was the kind of guy when we were going on breaking down doors and stuff like that, he would walk right through the door, break a whole door down. This is a big guy. And if he retired, he went to Florida with his wife. And he calls me up one day. I hadn't heard from him in like 25 years. And he says, John, I got to tell you what happened to me. I said, what happened? Everything okay? He says, no, I got to tell you. He moves to Florida. Moves a little house down there with his wife. And one Sunday morning, his wife decides to walk around the neighborhood and see what it's like. So she happens to see this church and some music going on. She walked in. Apparently, she liked it. She went home and said, his name was Fred. She said, Fred, I want you to come with me next week. This was really nice going to see these people and the service and the singing. Not me. But his wife wouldn't give up. He was into all kinds of computer things. She says, listen, if you come with me one time, I'll buy you that thing. Wife was tough. Tough cop, right? She could have been, right? Anyway, he goes with her. He sits by the door in the back of the church in case he has to leave. Anyway, he's sitting there, and he says, John, this is why I got to tell you what happened. I said, what happened, Fred? What happened? He says, I'm sitting there. There's a guy talking. I guess it was the pastor. And at some point, he was making an altar call for people to come up for salvation. He said, John, somebody behind me grabbed me by my collar and lifted me up out of my seat and pushing me toward the front. He says, I looked behind me. I was going to knock him out. He says, John, there was nothing there. Pushed him right to the front, right? When he got to the front of this church, he just started to cry.
Yeah.
I don't know what his life was like before, but something happened to him as a kid growing up. And he gave his heart to the Lord.
Praise God.
He's a deacon in that church now.
That's awesome.
Praise God.
It's awesome.
So, amen. Whatever you're listening to us, I don't care what your problem is. God has a solution for
it. That's right.
Whether it comes from a cop or a firefighter or whoever, or just somebody anywhere. I tell this to my church all the time, at least once or twice at every service. The last thing that Jesus did, the last orders he gave to his crew, was go. And tell them. That's all he said. Yes. Go and tell.
Yes.
Not to preach.
That's right.
Not to collect, but just go and tell them.
That's right.
And he'll do the rest.
That's it.
And I'll tell you, I've done that with people, and they said, well, I don't know how to talk. I said, listen, can you say God bless you?
Yeah. That's right.
I said, you're a Christian. You can bless people. Just say God bless you. I said, it's amazing when you say God bless you to some stranger.
That's right.
And you know what comes back? And a lot of times, God bless you too.
That's true.
We can bless people. Who knows what they're going through, but God knows.
That's right.
It's so true.
So again, listen, you want to be in an exciting job, become a cop, a Christian cop.
Yes.
Because God will use you like you wouldn't believe it. Even as a pastor. As a cop, I was able to walk into places that no pastor
nobody could go. That's right.
And I had people that I had arrested that had a so-called sit down in the chair, you can't leave. Now I had a chance to talk to them.
That's right.
Now, whether immediately they got saved or they changed their life, no, that's not the case. We put something into their mind and their heart, God will do the rest.
That's it.
And I've had so many testimonies like that by people. I said, just say God bless you. Even when I see these gentlemen that are older, they were on different ships, and they were in Vietnam, and they were in different places.
Yeah.
I go up and say to them, I don't go up and say, thank you for your service.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, you were on that ship? Wow, you did that? And he starts telling me all about the ship.
That's right.
And as soon as he goes through that, then I'll say, God bless you. Oh, I've had them cry.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Yes. God bless. If you can't say God bless you as a Christian, there's something wrong with you.
Amen.
That's right.
Because you put some blessing in a person's life.
Amen.
And if you want, like I said, you want an exciting job, you want to go to witness to people as a cop. We see the worst people every day. There's people in the worst situations.
Amen.
We've had cops pray for people on AIDS.
That's right. Yep. That's right.
Pray for people that were lost. We find this kid, whatever. These are all things that we have in God's power. But again, we want you to know this. When you see a cop, go up to him and say, how you doing? God bless you. I'm talking to Christians now. Like I started out before, I would never think that Paul the Apostle could get saved. He was a murderer.
That's right.
But God had him picked for a job.
That's right.
That no one else could do.
Yes.
You read his readings and the places he went and the things that happened, and imagine he's a cop being beat up by cops.
Sure.
Hey.
And here is God.
And not only that, in different languages.
Yep.
But he never stopped. He just kept going. There's a man I want to meet in heaven.
Amen. Pastor, it's funny you say that. I always say this, and Reverend Bill can attest this. If you asked me 15 years ago if I'd be sitting here with you guys now,
talking
to you guys about Jesus, I'd say you're out of your minds. I'd say no way. But like God had a different plan. I'm saying he's had a plan for all of us. Just real quick again, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention how God has blessed me. God has blessed me 1,000 times over. Ever since I was sick, and He healed me, and He restored my life in more ways than one. And I'm blessed with a beautiful wife at home. I married Christine, and I was told I would never be able to have children. And we were able to. My wife conceived. We were married in 2014, and we had a beautiful my first daughter, my first baby in 2016. Amelia was born to be a March of 2016, and just another quick testimony to the goodness of God.
That's
my
right.
My daughter was born in 2016, and in 2018, she too was now diagnosed with stage 4 cancer.
Wow.
So you talk about a punch in the gut. Here I was. I was like, you know, I'm not looking for a pity party. I'm not looking for to feel bad. It's, you know, a sob story. But you know, it's one thing when you're going through yourself, but then when your kid's going through it, I was like, you know, what the heck? You know what I'm saying. So here we were again now as a family now, back on our knees, and praying and believing God. And God once again, all glory to Him, proved Himself strong. He came through again, and He healed my daughter. My daughter went through a vigorous treatment. She went through a crazy treatment, you know, chemotherapy and resections, and immunotherapy and stem cell transplants and stuff like that. But praise God that here we are on today's date, and she's cancer free. She's in a survivorship program, and she's healthy, and she's beautiful, and she's going to live a long life. Like we all are. That's a promise.
That's the evidence.
Amen. The evidence. Amen. Yes. Amen. She's going to live a long life. So
it's so
real. It's real. It's not a book that is a fables. That, it's a book that has the truth in it.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
In fact, you know what? Don't look in there. And watch everybody read for their Bible now.
Yeah. I hear. Amen.
It's so true. He honors those that have a contrite heart, broken heart. And if there's anybody out there that is experiencing that, I mean, especially in our culture today, there's such anxiety and such worry, you know, about everything in society is just turned upside down.
Look at this. Where can you hide in this world right now where you can't get hit with a missile?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Not even in space.
Amen, John.
Not even in space.
But the encouragement here is, going back to my story, you know, here we are in a state that is run by dictators, and we're on this platform overlooking East Berlin across the wall. We're on that platform that President Kennedy and President Ronald Reagan declared to the Russians, tear down this wall.
Mm.
We all remember that, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
And so my partner and I felt led. We were convicted. We needed to pray for these people. And we began to pray.
Prayer changes things.
But here's the deal, though. Here's the deal. The enemy came in as we were praying, and he was speaking to me. That spirit, that evil spirit, was speaking to me. And he was saying, look what you got here. You got the pillboxes. You got the dogs. You got machine guns. You got barbed wire. You got this wall. Fast forward 9 years. I'm in my living room. TV is on, and that wall was coming down, and the tears, because he brought me back to that time.
He waits for the right time in the right place.
Exactly.
Not our time.
But he is faithful. See, this is the thing about our God, for those that are out there that are listening. It's that he's faithful.
Amen.
He's faithful, and he has angels that we don't even realize sometimes. I mean, the story of Mike DeSanza,
mm-hmm.
you know, Mike's story where one of the subway booths was under attack, and they go in there and they're trying to break it up. All right, they were ushering them up to the street to put in the radio car, and. And all of a sudden, he says, where's the other two guys that were helping me? No, there was no. He gives his angels charge.
That's right.
Over the Bible says. Amen. And in this particular instance, our brother got...
I laugh at that word, charge. I could see Jesus saying, charge! Get over there, charge.
So many aspects, you know. Sometimes, you know, we're in situations.
It's exciting to be a Christian.
I second that.
We're trying to tell you that.
Well, we're headed another story. We're headed for Washington to share the gospel to over 1 million people in 1980. 1980 was a pivotal year for the ministry, and here we are in Washington. And all of a sudden, you know, God opened up. There's a picture, you can see it, of us with the banners and presenting the gospel in the Capitol. And so we're on our way there, and I rented a bus with 40 of us, about 40, 45. And all of a sudden, the bus pulls over. So we're saying, what happened? So we run to the front. Jerry and I run to the front and say, what's the matter? To the bus driver. He says, I want to receive Jesus. I want to receive what we were sharing on the bus. We were boasting in the Lord, you know, as we were going there, sharing testimonies. And he overheard us. He heard the gospel. And he wanted the same God that we served. And that day he got saved.
This is what I was saying before. You got people out there, you want to become a witness. When you stop them, they got to stay there and listen to what you're saying. It's kind of funny.
It is.
I was saved by a cop, right?
It's true.
He held on to me till I said yes.
But I'm really, you know.
Being a Christian is exciting.
Exactly. I always said that.
It's not boring.
It's never boring.
Never boring.
Never boring. So currently, what are we doing now? We don't live in the past. As Christians, we don't live in the past.
No.
We enjoy some of the victories we received, but it's
greater ones coming.
That's right.
Exactly. Greater works will you do in my name. Yep. So what are we doing? God has opened the door.
Amen.
We're believing for an open heaven over Staten Island.
Amen.
And he opened the door.
Open the church door.
He opened the door to the north side of a hospital, where we can go in there now twice a week
and pray.
And what do you think they're asking us to do? Pray with the patients.
Yeah.
It just blew my mind. Where do you get somebody that wants you to come in and pray?
Amen.
Because they've seen it work.
Right? It was handed to us. Yeah. It was literally handed to us. And so now we're seeing, out of that outcome of praying with, we had the victory with our dear brother Reggie, who was in the hospital at that time. That's the reason why we're here this afternoon, because of the producer, director of these programs, received the prayer of faith.
Amen.
And I believe he was healed that day too.
Amen.
That's one aspect. The other current aspect is that we're going out there. As a church, Faith Community Church.
Faithfully.
Faithfully.
You have to leave the church.
You know, and we have an evangelistic team that goes out twice a month also. And where do we go? We go where Jesus would go. And that's, he is a friend of sinners.
Where the church tells you not to go.
Exactly. Well, in some churches. Some churches. Yeah. But I'm thankful for our church, Faith Community Church, and your church.
Yeah, we've been doing a lot of
you know,
work.
Yes. I'm grateful.
That's what Jesus said. Tell them.
He
didn't say save them. He can't.
That's it.
We can't save anybody.
That's not our job.
But
that's
we can point them in the right direction.
That's right.
So true.
And our testimony of what God did for us.
That's right.
Hey.
Amen.
I don't care what you think about it. I know what happened to me.
That's right. That's right.
So what we're seeing in now at the Bowery Mission, you know, the Bible says that if one sinner comes to Christ, all of heaven rejoice.
Amen.
I can tell you and the audience that every time we've gone, we've had a minimum of 10, 15 men
come
and women come to receive Christ.
Amen.
I'm just so
and every
grateful.
One of them had a negative thing with cops.
We've mentioned it.
Yeah, we mentioned it from the platform.
So what happened when we mentioned it, Rev?
Yeah.
What about that security guard who worked in that chapel? He came to
Christ. Amen. Yep.
Accepted Amen. Christ.
Praise God.
Because of our testimonies.
Yes. Amen.
You can't win the perfect people. They think they're perfect. You
well,
can only
true.
Learn the people who
it's
say,
true.
I give up.
It's true.
I'm messed up.
It's true.
Oh, yeah.
And so we're sharing the gospel. Currently now in the Bowery Mission, in the hospitals, and wherever else God hands us.
Amen.
And that's what he's doing. He's handing us because he sees the obedience in our hearts. Mm. And that's paramount. The Bible says that he desires obedience rather than sacrifice.
Yeah. Amen.
And it's so true.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If I could share.
Another way to say it is, He wants the truth, not just religion.
Yeah,
it's true.
Amen.
So true.
Amen.
You know, it's not about religion.
No.
It's about our relationship with
Christ.
God.
Amen.
That's why we, as witnesses, what happened to us, we can share that with people.
Amen.
Amen.
You may not believe it, but this is what happened to me.
Amen.
And so on.
Amen.
If I could share one last thing,
yes, sure.
But we all share the
Bowery.
For all those who are watching, you know, listen, I, you know, we're talking about, you know, life as, you know, being a Christian cop, but I think all of us here can, our prayer is that all of you who are watching would that the words that we're sharing, they would impact you and touch you guys in a way, like, you know, like not through us, but through the power of the Holy Spirit. I say this, I don't say this in a hard way, you know. Listen, we share this with as many people as we can. Tomorrow, as we all know, is not promised.
That's
tomorrow,
right.
but our eternity is,
yes,
and our eternity with Christ is, and that comes by means of having a relationship with Christ. It means by opening up your heart, repenting of your sin, accepting Christ in your heart as Lord and Savior, and promising to live life unto Him, loving Him and honoring Him the best you could all the days of your life. And the promise that He makes for us is that we'll be with Him forever. And it's just what we're all saying here, and we're all sharing our hearts with you, is if what we're saying is nonsense, you have nothing to lose. But if what we're saying is true, you have everything to gain. Everything. And that was said to me. Listen, all three of us here were sitting on that receiving end where you guys were at one point. And God had touched us and met us where we are. And in turn, like Pastor John was just saying, we're being obedient to what God has told us to do. We can go and to share this good news. We want to share this good news to all those who have ears to hear and eyes to see and hearts to receive, and the hopes and prayers that you guys would come to this place too. That's the gist of it, right? That's what we do.
That's it.
And I'll say no more.
We have
that's
a motto in our church. It works like this: whatever the problem, Jesus is the answer.
Amen.
That's
not
right.
Us.
Amen.
Not
right.
The church.
That's right.
Jesus is the answer.
Yes.
Reach
right.
out and talk to Him.
Amen.
Ask Him to come into your life, and you'd be surprised what happens.
Amen.
That's right. We're not the message. We're just the messengers.
That's right.
That's right.
And that's what we've been called to do.
Amen.
To speak. How shall they hear unless someone has sent?
That's right.
Doesn't the scripture say
that's
that?
That's right.
And I'm so grateful.
Blessed.
With my brother's here today. I mean, I'm in awe of what we've experienced in life. And if we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is alive.
Amen.
And that He's able to save.
Yes.
He's able to heal. He's able to restore.
Yes.
Amen.
Which He did for us.
Amen. He's still doing.
So He is no respecter of persons.
Yes.
And if any man be in Christ.
He's a new creation.
We're
come on. No, right, come on.
He's a new creation. Old things have passed away and all things become new.
Amen to that.
The old is gone.
Reverend.
God bless you and keep coming. Keep listening.
Amen.
Open that book you call the Bible and God will help you.
God bless you.
God bless you guys.